Hello there and welcome to KCM Lite, to our online service. We're glad today that you could join us. So a very good morning or a very good afternoon or a very good evening, depending on when you're watching us. And we trust that you'll know the Lord's presence as we worship together. We have missed not being able to meet, but with the announcement this week made by the government, we do hope there's now a light at the end of the tunnel. So keep on keeping on, guys, and hopefully in the not too distant future we might be able to meet up again in worship. That'll be great, won't it? As many of you will already know, we need to announce that our dear sister Jean Humphreys was promoted to glory in the early hours of Thursday morning and has gone to be with the Lord, whom she very much loved. Jean has been a part of the church here for many years and is a member of KCM as well, and we thank God for her life and for a real trust and faith in the Lord. And I ask that you'll continue in your prayers for the family at this time, with all the things that need to be arranged and sorted through, and as they work through their grief, just keep them in your prayers, won't you? We're going to pray now and offer ourselves and all that is on our hearts and minds just to the Lord in prayer as we gather to worship Him. Let us pray. Father God, creator and giver of all life, we praise you and thank you for your great love towards us, so fully revealed in the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the life that you have given to us, with all its possibilities for growth and all its opportunities for service, and for that new life that is offered to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, today we want to thank you that your love for us is stronger than death, and that nothing can separate us from your love. And thank you that through the death of Christ on the cross, you've showed us the full extent of your love. And by raising him from the dead, you've promised that those who trust in him will share in his resurrection life. And today we just want to pause and thank you that this trust in the Lord Jesus was so evident in Jean's life. We thank you, Lord, for all that you meant to her. We thank you, Lord, for all that she was to those who loved her, and for everything in her life that reflected you. We thank you for the love that she gave and that she received while she was with us on earth, for the joyous, happy memories that will be cherished, and for Jean's love and zest for life. And God of all comfort and compassion, we recall that your Son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus's friend. And we do ask now that you will look with compassion on Jean's family. Lord, would you grant them your comfort, your strength, and an awareness of your presence and your love in all things. Enable them to grieve Jean's loss in the way that is right for them, and be to them all that they will need at this time, Father, we pray. And Lord God, we ask today that we might all see afresh and more deeply the meaning of our own lives, that you may give us the wisdom and grace to use the time that is given to us here on earth wisely, that we may grasp that life is a gift from you that should be centered on you, and that each of us may turn to Jesus Christ and follow in his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. So Creator God, the maker of all things, the great I am, the three in one, we praise and we bless your holy name. Hear us, hear our prayer as we come to you in worship today, for we ask it in the name of your dear Son, our Saviour and Lord. Amen.
Moving on the waters, who is holding up the moon, who is peeling back the darkness with the burning light of noon. standing on the mountains, who is on the earth below, who is bigger than the heavens, and the lover of my soul. Creator God, He is Yahweh. The great I am, He is Yahweh. The Lord of all, He is Yahweh. Prince of Sharon, He is Yahweh. The righteous Son, He is Yahweh. The three in one, He is Yahweh. Who is He that makes me happy? Who is He that gives me peace? Who is He that brings me comfort and turns the bitter into sweet? Who is stirring up my passion? Who is rising up in me? My hunger with everything I need. Creator God, He is Yahweh. The great I am, He is Yahweh. The Lord of all, He is Yahweh. Rose of Sharon, He is Yahweh. The righteous Son, He is Yahweh. The three in one, He is Yahweh. Forever You will reign. Every knee will bow before You. Every tongue will confess Your name. All the angels give You glory as they stand before Your throne. While here on earth we gather Your name alone, alone.
Creator God, He is Yahweh. The great I am, He is Yahweh. The Lord of all, He is Yahweh.
Yes, Lord, You are.
Rose of Sharon, He is Yahweh. The righteous Son, He is Yahweh. The three in one, He is Yahweh.
Yeah.
Well, it's always good to hear good news, isn't it? And we've got some for you today. We want to say congratulations to James and Laura, who are expecting a baby. Isn't that wonderful news? One very proud and happy and excited granddad to be. So that's James and Laura, and that's not all we got to say as well, because we also want to say congratulations to Hannah and Scott, who are also expecting as well. And get this, both of them, their due date is in the middle of July, within a week of each other. Isn't that amazing? Two of the three pastors are going to be granddads. Wow, that's fantastic news. Congratulations. And while we're on the subject of babies, we've got some more wonderful news for you. I don't know whether some of you know that Paul and Sally are grandparents for the third time. There's a lovely picture of Sienna Grace Giddings praising the Lord. So congratulations. Sienna was born to Ben and Darcy just a week ago. So that's wonderful, wonderful news, isn't it? And very exciting. We're glad to be able to share that with you. We're going to play a game now, and many of you may have seen this on television. It's a show, Catchphrase, where we get images that are being portrayed and they're trying to give over some phrase or some words. So let's have a go now, shall we, and just see how we do. You have to look and have to watch, and it'll be on the screen, and maybe shout out what you think the answer is. We're going to go give you three today, and then when we've gone through the three, we'll give you the answers. So tune in. Here is your first catchphrase for today. Catchphrase number one. Say what you see. Have a look and say what you see. Hope you've all got that one. That's number one. Here's number two coming up just now. Say what you see. What's the phrase being highlighted here? Say what you see. Any of you think you got that one? Well, here's the final one for today. Let's see how you're doing. The last one, catchphrase three. Have a look. Say what you see. Say what you see. What's happening there? What's the phrase? Well, how do you think you did in that one? Some of you may have thought, well, that was a bit hard. Maybe didn't get any, or maybe one. Maybe a couple of you got two, or maybe even three. I don't know if you tuned in to what's happening. Do you want the answers? Do you want to know how you did? Yeah, well, here we go then. Here's the first one. Catchphrase number one. You can see he's there in the middle. But whereabouts is he? He's in a place called Nowhere. He's in where? Do you get it? Can you get the answer? The answer is in the middle of nowhere. In the middle of nowhere. I hope you managed to get that one. What about the second one? Was that a bit easier, do you think? Let's have a look at catchphrase number two. What have we got here? We've got a huge thumb, and it's got a plaster on. It's sore, and it's going out to the road. Have you got it? Has it come to you? Yes. The answer is... the catchphrase is sticking out like a sore thumb. Hope you got that. Last one now. Here we go. Can you remember what this one was? He's rubbing the lamp. What comes out of the lamp? A genie. What does a genie give you? A wish. And what's he got? So what is it? We've put all that together. What's the answer to catchphrase number three? The answer is wishbone. Wishbone. There we go. Well, I hope you managed to be able to get those few just there in that catchphrase. Now, later on, we're going to be picking up again in our Origins series. And I want you to be able to catch five words or phrases that are being portrayed in the passage we'll be looking at later on in Genesis chapter 2. I'm going to tell you what those five words are now so that you can know. And they are the word formed, dust of the land, breathed, garden, and royal priesthood. Those are the five words I want you to listen out to. And we're going to have some readings now that Sue is going to bring to us. And each one of those words features consecutively in those five readings. So listen out for the first reading, the word form, the second reading, dust of the land, third breathe, the fourth garden, and the fifth royal priesthood. Let's listen to God's word now as Sue reads to us.
Hello, church. I hope you've had a chance like I have to be able to get into the garden and see the signs of spring. There are five short readings today, and the first is taken from Isaiah chapter 44, verses 1 to 5. But now listen, Jacob, my servant Israel, whom I have chosen. This is what the Lord says, He who made you, who formed you in the womb, and who will help you. Do not be afraid, Jacob, my servant, Jeshurun, whom I have chosen. For I will pour water on the thirsty land, and streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my spirit on your offspring, and my blessing on your descendants. They will spring up like grass in a meadow, like poplar trees by flowing streams. Some will say, I belong to the Lord. Others will call themselves by the name of Jacob. Still others will write on their hand, the Lord's, and will take the name Israel. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 45 to 49. So it is written, the first man Adam became a living being, the last Adam a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural, and after that the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth, the second man is of heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we have borne the image of the earthly man, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly man. And next, John chapter 20, verses 19 to 23. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that he breathed on them and said, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Next is John chapter 19, verses 41 and 42. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. And the last reading is from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Stay safe, everyone, and I hopefully will be able to see each other soon.
Yes, it's time once again to bring you some more of those fantastic Bible facts. Here we are, off with the first one today. Now, I'm sure you've all heard the story of David and the huge giant Goliath, the champion of the Philistines. But did you know that we are told in 1 Samuel chapter 17 verse 5 that Goliath wore a coat of mail or armor that weighed in at 58 kilograms, which is about 9 stone. I know, it's unbelievable, isn't it? That is some weight to carry around. However, we all know, don't we, that it didn't do him much good. And after defeating Goliath, David, the young shepherd boy, put his armor into his tent. Maybe, I don't know, he used it as a coffee table or something, I'm not sure. Now, here's our second amazing Bible fact today. We all appreciate the work of the worship band when we're able to meet together, don't we? But did you know that we're told in 1 Chronicles chapter 23 verse 5 that King David had a worship band of 4,000 people? I know, that's an amazing number to draw on, isn't it? Obviously, David liked to take on big things. But 4,000 strong worship band. Wow. Pastor Tim, could you imagine putting together the worship band rota for that? Here's a final one now today. Did you know that in 2 Kings chapter 10, verse 27, we're told that after the temple of Baal was destroyed, that the Israelites used it as a toilet? Yeah, quite a statement, isn't it, about what they thought about the temple of Baal. But I'm sure the Israelites were relieved to see it go. Anyway, that's all that we've got time for this week on our fantastic Bible facts. We're going to quiet things down now, and Jeff is going to lead us in our time of prayer and intercession.
Good morning, church. We continue to live in very difficult times, and more than ever, I'm sure you feel, as I do, that these are the times that we need to draw ever closer to God, that he may see us through these difficult times. The psalmist in Psalm 55 calls us to cast our burdens upon him, and he will sustain us. For as Paul points out in Philippians, it is God's will that we should experience his peace, a peace which passes all understanding, that we may indeed rest in him. With these things in mind, let us now pray together and pray that we may find ourselves drawing ever closer to him in this time of uncertainty. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, praying to you, the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, creator of heaven and earth, author of life, and source of love. Father, we thank you for all your goodness to us and all the mercies that we receive from your grace. But Father, we come to you once again today in a time of turmoil, anxiety, confusion, and with a very uncertain future. Father, we read in the first part of your holy word that Satan came into this world and tempted us to doubt you, his purpose being to draw us ever away from you. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that we will be able to withstand that temptation and throw it aside, that we may indeed truly draw closer to you. For Father, we pray that we may all learn to trust you more, more than perhaps we've ever done before, knowing that in you we can indeed place our trust. And when we pray to you with our anxieties, we can do so knowing that we can leave that prayer with you, that you will answer that prayer, and that we don't need, as we so often do, to continue to worry about the things that we have just prayed for. Father, help us never to worry after prayer, because, Lord, you are the one true God. You are God. And Father, we pray that we may increase to perfection our belief in you, not only your reality and your loving presence, but every aspect of your holy word, that we may indeed live as you want us to live. For Lord, we know that seeing is not believing in regard to you, but believing is seeing. And so, Lord, we pray that you will help us to believe in you fully, that we may see and experience your love and your presence, your wisdom and your power, that we may have no doubt that you are there with us, for us, and keeping us safe. Father, we pray that in drawing closer to you, through greater trust in you, through greater belief in you, casting our burdens upon you, knowing that you will sustain us, that we may then begin to embody the person of Jesus in a more powerful and visible way, and that each one of us may be used by you to be lights in the world, lights to bring hope where there is despair, lights to bring unity where there is division, lights to bring love where there is hatred, lights to break down barriers where human beings raise barriers between themselves. Lord, we love you, we bless you, we thank you for all that you are. Lord, give us all that we need to display you in the loving, attractive, and powerful manner in which you came into this world and drew people to you. Father, it is into your hands that we place ourselves and our futures, knowing that beyond all doubt, we are in the safest hands that could ever be, in the blessed, mighty power of the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Immortal, invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. Most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days. Almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Unresting, unhasting, and silent as light, nor wanting, nor wasting, thou rulest in might. Thy justice like mountains, high soaring above, thy clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. Almighty, victorious, your great name is glorious. Almighty, victorious, your great name we praise, O Lord. To all life thou givest, the great and the small, to all life thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish as leaves on the tree, and wither and perish, but naught changeth thee. Great Father of glory, pure Father of light, thine angels adore thee, all veiling their sight. All praise we would render,
carrying on with our origin series today in the book of Genesis, and I hope, as I said at the start of this series, that you're still loving me, even though I may be looking to interpret Genesis in a way that's different to how you understand it. But we're going to press on today, and I just want to remind you at the beginning of this time that what we've talked about viewing the text through a Western mindset, or if you like, through Western eyes, and how, in the same way as looking through these sunglasses, it can colour or it can set us in a particular way of looking at the passage that is different than the way that the author intended. And I said that we need to try and take off our Western eyes and our Western way of looking at things and our mindset, and try and look at the text through the ancient Near East Hebrew mindset.
Perhaps we can illustrate how this might look by way of an illustration to show us how we think in different ways. If I asked you the question, what is a cow? What would you say? Well, with Western eyes on, I suppose many of us would answer that by saying that it's a large animal, weighing maybe half a ton or more, with four legs, usually black or white or brown. But if I asked the same question to somebody of the ancient Near East, they would probably describe a cow as a creature that eats grass, provides milk for us to drink, and meat for us to eat. Now, do you see in the ancient Hebrew way of thinking that the cow's existence is described in functional terms to do with its purpose or role rather than with regard to its material components? Now, we need to hold that and remember that as we look at these opening chapters of Genesis. And we'll be exploring some of the words and the concepts used in Genesis 2 that we'll refer to earlier on, those five words or phrases that we looked at earlier in the service. But just for now, by way of a very brief recap, in Genesis chapter 1 a few weeks back, we saw God creating order and function in the whole cosmos, which culminated in day 7, where God rests, when he ceases creating and settles into his creation. And we looked at how this was temple language, and that the 7-day creation account portrays creation as the first or the archetypal temple. Now, as we look at this second creation account in Genesis 2 today, I believe the author is trying to paint a picture using words or phrases that we need to catch on to today, a bit like we were trying to catch on with the catchphrases earlier on. And in looking and discovering what that picture may be, some of us may have to consider this text in a way that's different from how we've always thought about it. So let's pin back our luggles, let's open our hearts and our minds, and let's just listen to God's word and crack on, as we've got a lot to get through today. So I'm going to read now from the scriptures, from Genesis chapter 2, beginning at verse 4 through to verse 17. And I'm going to be reading from the English Standard Version. And this is what it says. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that Yahweh God made the earth and the heavens, when no bush of the field was yet in the land and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up. For Yahweh God had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground. And a mist was going up from the land and was watering the whole face of the ground. Then Yahweh God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. And Yahweh God planted a garden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground Yahweh God made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A river flowed out of Eden to water the ground, and there it divided and became four rivers. The name of the first is the Pishon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold. And the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stones are there. And the name of the second river is the Gihon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Cush. And the name of the third river is the Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. Yahweh God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And Yahweh God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." Here ends the reading of God's word. Amen. What do you think is the best film sequel that you've seen? Sometimes the sequel to a film's not really very good, are they? Nowhere near as good as the first one. But other times you can get really great sequels. And I think of sequels, for instance, like Lord of the Ring Two Towers, which was a great film after the first one. Or maybe another great sequel would be The Empire Strikes Back, following on after Star Wars. Or one of my personal favourite sequels, the beautifully titled Paddington 2. Anyway, you may be wondering why I'm asking that. Well, when we look at Genesis 2, it's apparent that there are some differences with Genesis 1, which have led some to believe that this is a different creation account. There is, for instance, a different order, as in Genesis 1, humanity is the final act of creation after plants and animals. But here in Genesis 2, we see that it appears that humans come first. Also in Genesis 1, the term used for God is the word Elohim. But in Genesis 2, the divine covenant name of Yahweh is added and used throughout the chapter. While in light of some of these differences, it has been suggested that another author wrote Genesis 2, or maybe that it was written as a second complementary creation account. And some have said that the account of Genesis 2 is actually an elaboration or a zooming in on the creation of humanity in day 6. Today, I want to start off by suggesting that this second creation account in Genesis 2 is actually a sequel to the one that we find in chapter 1. In other words, chapter 2 follows on after chapter 1. We're not getting too deep too early, are we? No, good. So what we're looking at today is the sequel to the 7 days of creation. Now in Genesis chapter 1 verse 1 to chapter 2 verse 3, we saw God ordering and creating everything to function as a kind of cosmic temple. And here in chapter 2, I want to suggest, in the sequel, we find where the center of that cosmic temple is, who is put there, and why. Let's get on with it then, shall we? Well, we kick off in verse 4. And it starts us off and points us with these words in the direction of a sequel, because it says this: these are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that Yahweh God made the earth and the heavens. Now, if you'd like to do a bit of detective work, you'll find that this phrase used here in this opening of verse 4 is actually found another 10 times throughout the book of Genesis. So look out for it if you read through, won't you? It's a literary device used by the author, and typically what we get is the name of a person and then that person's descendants. So I suppose what we could say is that it's a way of telling us what comes after that named person. We see the phrase appear, for instance, in chapter 5, verse 1. The generations of Adam are told as an introduction for what comes next. Then in chapter 6, verse 9, the generations of Noah, and then what followed on after him. Then we have the sons of Noah in chapter 10. Then we have Shem, and we have Terah, and Ishmael, and Esau, and finally Jacob in chapter 37. So this repeated phrase in Genesis then, that introduces here, if we use it in the same way that we do here in Genesis 2, it shows us that it's an introductory phrase that refers to what is going to come after. In other words, what comes after the creation of the heavens and the earth in Genesis 1, the follow-on, so to speak. So Genesis 2 is not a recap, I don't believe, or a second different account, but rather a sequel, picking up from where Genesis 1 left off. Let's look at what it says, shall we? After this introductory phase of verse 4, we're told in verse 5 that there was no bush of the field or plant of the field that had yet sprung up. Now, the more astute of you may be thinking and asking now, how does that work in relation to Genesis chapter 1 verse 11, where we're told about the land producing vegetation? How does that work if this is a sequel? Well, notice that here in chapter 2 verse 5, the plants mentioned are qualified. We're told the plants are those of the field, something that unfortunately the new NIV version omits to tell us, and that they were plants that needed to be worked by mankind, working the ground, as it says at the end of this verse. And that gives us a clue that what is referred to here in chapter 2 are cultivated crops rather than general vegetation as in Genesis 1. So after this little bit about cultivated plants or crops and a reference to God's way of irrigating the land via a mist or, depending on your translation, waters or whatever it is, the focus in verse 7 falls on one primal human being who is to be given a remarkable task. We're told in verse 7 that Yahweh God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. Aha, we say, looking at the text through our Western eyes. Well, surely this verse is telling us about how the first human came about, isn't it? You know, what he was made from and how. When it says that God formed a man from the dust of the ground, doesn't it mean he physically moulded him before breathing life into him? Now, hang on just a minute, you guys. Let's try and remember to look at this how an ancient Hebrew would have, and not through our Western scientific mindset or eyes. When we read in verse 7 that God formed Adam from the dust of the ground and then breathed life into him, we need to look at how these words function elsewhere in the Bible and what themes are being stated here in this origins account that are developed in the rest of Scripture. Now, this Hebrew word yatsar, which is translated formed here, is the first of our five words that were mentioned earlier. Can you remember what they were? Formed is the first one. It's used in quite a few Old Testament passages, and it's quite an interesting exercise, if you can, to look up all the occurrences of the word and the context in which you find them. And that's something I've done. So just to give you a brief flavor, it's used, this word formed, to say that God formed events to take place. Interesting, wasn't it? It's used to say that God formed the seasons. He says that he formed the emotions and the inclinations of the heart. Can you see that it's not always referring to something physical here? And it goes on to say that he formed the nation of Israel, as we heard mentioned in the reading that we had earlier from Isaiah. Now, the focus of this word's usage then is not so much on material molding, but rather on what something was formed for, what its purpose was. When God created and formed Israel, it isn't referring to him physically molding the nation, but rather to the form and electing of them for a particular role or function. So, in Genesis 2 here, the focus isn't that invisible hands molded some dust, take off the Western eyes, but rather that Yahweh God formed Adam in the way that he formed Israel, by calling him out to be the first person to function in a particular vocation. Now that leads us on to our second word or phrase from earlier. The first one was formed. Can you remember the second one? Dust of the ground. Is this text telling us that dust of the ground was a material from which God molded Adam? Well, besides the fact that you can't mold dust anyway, it's good to note that the Hebrew phrasing literally reads here, God formed the human dust of the ground. The words from the, what some English translations add, are not there in the Hebrew. Now, when we read it in this way, that Adam was formed dust of the ground, we see that it's not telling us what chemical components the man was made up of. That's not how the ancient Hebrews would have understood this and looked at it. But rather what we see here, taking off our Western eyes again, is actually a common way to describe human identity that is used in the Old Testament and in other ancient Near Eastern cultures. How many of you remember what God says in the next chapter to Adam? In chapter 3, verse 19, he says, "For dust you are, and to dust you will return." We're told in Psalm 103, verse 14, aren't we, that God knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. That's right. And in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 20, we're reminded that all come from dust and all to dust shall return. Dust of the land or dust of the earth is a reference not to our founding substance, but to our essence and our identity as human beings. In that second reading that Sue brought to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul uses this phrase in a similar way. He's talking about Christ's resurrection body and comparing it to Adam's as a man of dust, someone who is subject to mortality and must be changed in order to be immortal and imperishable like Christ's resurrection body. In other words, this expression being formed from dust is used throughout the Bible as an idiom to denote that we're created mortal. Being made from dust is a statement about our essence and identity, not a claim about what we are made from physically. You see, contrary to what a lot of Christians may think, Adam was not created immortal in the beginning. That's a Greek concept, not a biblical Hebraic one. The text of Genesis shows us this by mentioning the provision of the tree of life in verse 9. Now think about it. Immortal people have no need of a tree of life. But rather, we're told in chapter 3, verse 22, that it's eating from this tree of life that gives us the potential of immortality. It's not some quality that Adam or we have in ourselves. We could say perhaps that the tree of life was the remedy to our human mortality. And when Adam and Eve were banished from the garden because of sin, they were therefore doomed to die because they lost access to the tree of life. And this is what Paul's referring to in Romans 5 when he says that death came through sin. Sin, in other words, cost us the solution to our mortality. By being banished from the garden because of sin, we lost access to the tree of life through which we could live forever. So that's how death came through sin. Now, verse 7, we're introduced to our third word or phrase. I remember the third one. We've had formed, we've had dust of the land, and the third one is breathed. We're told that Yahweh God breathed the breath of life into this human. Now again, having the breath of God or the breath of life is a term that is descriptive of humanity as a whole, not just to the individual human called Adam here. For instance, we read in Job chapter 34, verses 14 and 15, that if God withdrew his spirit and breath, all humanity would perish together and mankind would return to the dust. And also Isaiah chapter 42, verse 5 tells us that God gives breath to people on the earth and life to those who walk on it. Then we had the reading earlier from John, didn't we, where Jesus breathed on his disciples after he was raised from the dead. And this is probably referring to this scripture here in Genesis. And it's John's way, I believe, of saying that Jesus breathed the new creation life of the Spirit into his disciples to equip them for the task that lay ahead of them. And so, in chapter 2 here, the author is trying to paint a picture of one particular historical human creature called Adam. However, his focus is not on how that individual human is molded in a particular way that is different to us. Take the Western eyes off. But that this individual Adam, a real historical human being who lived on the earth, is representative of all humanity. He has a significance that goes beyond his individual existence, because what is true for him is true for all of us too. He was formed for a purpose, like we are. He's related to the dust of the earth, the dust of the ground, immortal like we are. Yet he's also related and connected to God through God's breath and being equipped for his task like we are. In other words, Adam is being used in an archetypal way here in chapter 2, in that he represents humanity and how humanity is to function in God's creation. So what is this function? What is this role portrayed in this representative human Adam to which humanity is formed and called? Well, in order to answer that, we need to look at what happens next in the narrative. What does God do with Adam? Well, God puts him into a garden that he's planted. Adam has been formed, has been chosen as one connected to the ground and to God for a role in a garden. But in order to see what this means, we need to zoom in and explore this garden a bit more. Because garden is the fourth of our five words that we had earlier. Now, I know that many of you like being out in the garden, don't you? And I know that a lot of you are actually very keen gardeners and you love gardening. I may not be the world's best gardener. I may not know too much about gardening, but I do love being out in the garden. I don't know, it's just something, is it just me or do you feel close to God in a garden? I do, I feel close to God. You know, my Sarah, she likes being out in the garden. And as many of you know, Sarah is very organized and she brings a lot of that organization to the garden as well. The other day I came home and she was kneeling down and she was reorganizing all of the plants. And I asked her what she was doing and she said to me, "I'm putting all our plants in alphabetical order." So I said to her, "You know, I don't know where you find the time." And she said to me, "It's right there next to the sage." Anyway, we are very fortunate and we are very blessed with a lovely garden that I love being in. And although we've made a few changes actually to our garden since we moved in, the previous owner had dug a hole in the garden patio area and he'd filled it with water. I think he meant well, but we filled it in. Anyway, all this talk about gardens, what's that got to do with what we're looking at here? What is this garden that God planted? What picture is the author trying to convey to us through this garden here? Well, firstly, don't picture your grandma's back garden or even maybe the garden of a stately home. Take those Western glasses off. You need to think more along the lines of the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. You see, ancient gardens were impressive. They were huge, enormous spaces that were created by kings as oases of life. Of course, this particular garden was planted by God himself, so that we know it must have been even grander and more amazing and wonderful and beautiful than we could ever imagine. So we're told in verse 8 that God planted this garden in a specific area of the earth called Eden, a word that means delight. And so this is a garden of delight. More wonderful than you could ever imagine. And specific features of this area of land are described that show us that it's not the whole earth that's being referred to, but a specific part at the center, which is going to function as a kind of inner sanctuary or most holy place in the center of God's creation temple. You see, creation with the Garden of Eden as its inner sanctuary was actually the first, the archetypal temple on which the tabernacle and the later temple were modeled. And we can see this from some of the things that are said about the garden in the text today that reappear later in descriptions of the temple. See, firstly, and most importantly for Israel, the tabernacle and a later temple was a place where you could experience God's unique presence. And likewise, in the Garden of Eden, Adam walked and he talked with God. This is alluded to in chapter 3, verse 8, where we're told that God is walking in the garden. Interestingly, this same verbal form used in that verse in chapter 3 of Genesis is also used to describe God's presence in the tabernacle in Leviticus chapter 26, verse 12, where we're told that God walks among Israel and that he will be their God. And also in Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 14, where God is said to walk in the midst of the Israelite camp. Then we're told in the description of the temple later in 1 Kings chapter 6 and 7 of garden-like imagery in the interior of the temple. We're told of gourds of open flowers, of palm trees carved into wood. We're told of pomegranates on the great big pillars outside, and that the capitals of those pillars are designed in the shape of a lily. All these are garden images identifying the temple with the Garden of Eden, where we're told in verse 9 that there were all kinds of trees pleasing to the eye and good for food. Then we have, of course, the golden lampstand that was in the tabernacle and the temple, the menorah, which we're told looked like a small flowering tree with seven branches and cups like shaped like almond flowers with buds and blossoms. Are you getting what the picture is here? This was a representation of the tree of life in the Garden of Eden that we're told about in verse 9. Also, just in, as in verse 10, we're told that there's a river that flowed out of Eden bringing life. If we look at Ezekiel's vision of the end time temple in chapter 47, what do we find? There, you guessed it. There's a river flowing from the center, a river that flowed out bringing life. And this is something that's also picked up in Revelation at the end of the book, along with many of the other images that we see here, where there's a river of the water of life that flows from the throne of God. And we see in Genesis again in verses 11 and 12, there's a reference to gold in the land and to onyx stones, both of which are included in the description of the tabernacle of the temple and were used in the high priestly garments. Then the entrance of the garden, we're told in chapter 3, verse 24, was from the east. That was also the direction which you came and entered the tabernacle and the later temple. Now, we haven't got time to go into more detail and to look at other scriptures, but do you see the picture that's been given here? Are you catching what the author is trying to get across about this garden? He's trying to show us that the Garden of Eden is the original sanctuary. It is the most holy place in the temple of God's creation, where God would be especially present to commune. Now, hold all of that ideas, all that we've just looked at together, and then we see in verse 15, Yahweh God took the man and put him into the garden. Now, here's an interesting one. The word for put in verse 15 is different to the one that is used early in the chapter. It means to place, but it's actually from the word nuach. Remember that word nuach that we looked at a couple of weeks ago, meaning to rest? Isn't that significant that the word there, he was placed to rest in the garden? What an interesting choice of words. And check this one out too. Adam is placed to put there to work and keep the garden. These are the same words and the same job description that were used and given to the priests who later on were to work and keep the temple in God's presence. Are you getting the picture here? Are you catching what the author is trying to say through these words and phrases about this garden sanctuary and Adam's role within it? Adam was put into the garden sanctuary at the center of God's cosmic temple to function as a royal priest or a priesthood. And here we have the last of our four phrases or words from earlier on in the service. Adam is given the role of performing priestly duties within the garden sanctuary and reigning on earth as God's vice-regent. Adam is really the first priest-king, and he is a type of the great priest-king who was to come, Jesus the Messiah. And so Genesis 1 is about God giving order and functions to the whole cosmos, in that he sets it up as a temple. And Genesis 2 continues the story with explaining the next phase, where the inner sanctuary in the center of the temple is located in a garden. And then Adam, the primal human being, is formed. He's connected both to the dust of the ground and to God through divine breath. And he's placed in the garden to function as a royal priesthood. So the picture being drawn for us in Genesis 2 is not how God formed Adam in the sense of a physical forming and what substance he was made of or anything like that, but rather it's being Adam being formed to function in the inner sanctuary of God's cosmic temple as a priest and vice regent in God's presence. Whew! I don't know about you, but I think I need a rest now. Your minds must be blown, because mine is too. Today we've had a lot to take in, and well done if you managed to keep up with it. But maybe in light of all that I've shared today, it'd be a good idea to go and read through this passage again several times without letting our Western eyes dictating to us how to interpret the text and what questions we bring to it, and trying instead to catch the phrases and words used by this ancient Hebrew author in order to paint a picture. I want to say we've had enough to look at today, but I just want to close by saying this, just a thought. You know, it's good to go back to our origins, isn't it? And remind ourselves of what we're all about. As human beings, we are actually creatures of longing. Our souls kind of long for satisfaction. Our hearts and our inner person and our flesh and our body cry out for contentment, for fulfillment, for significance and for purpose. But unfortunately, we look for it in all the wrong places. In this passage we've looked at today, Adam, as a representative of humanity, shows us and reminds us that we exist for a purpose. We were formed for a purpose. Our existence hasn't just come about by chance. We're formed by God. Yes, we're of dust, and yet we're able to relate with God. We are heaven and earth creatures, if you like, formed to function as a royal priesthood in the temple of God's presence. And even though this vocation was knocked off track by what happened in Genesis chapter 3, it has more than totally been restored and renewed in and through our great priest king, Jesus the Messiah. So at the end of this time, maybe your head's swimming a bit, please don't worry about that too much, but let's just pause. And let's just be still. And amidst all the pressing worries and the cares of life, amidst all the distractions and all the lures, let's get back to our origins and be reminded that God has made us for himself. And that it is in God's presence, in the place of his dwelling, and only there, that the real longing of our souls can find satisfaction. Maybe some of us need to hear that afresh today. Maybe some of us need to just recenter, to be reminded of who we are, of what we were formed for. And it's not for self-absorbed pleasure-seeking. It's not to work every hour that we can trying to find our identity in our jobs. It's not living and dwelling in our past mistakes and failures. But it's about being with God in the place that he dwells to find satisfaction, living and working in his presence. Let's pray, shall we? Father God, we just bless you and thank you. There's been a lot to look at today, but Lord, I pray that'll just sink into our hearts and our minds. And we thank you for that reminder in this representative Adam of who you called us to be. We thank you that, Lord, you call us into the place of your presence, that place where you dwell. And we want to do that now, Lord. We want to draw near to you. We want to find that refreshment, that rest for our souls that can only come in and through you. So Father, may this sink, may the truths of what we looked at today sink into our hearts and minds. May we know your presence in all that we are and all that we do through this week. May we be that royal priesthood renewed in and through Jesus Christ, that, Lord, bring you the praise and the worship that you deserve, and that your life may flow in us and out of us to all those that we meet. Father, we bless you and we thank you and we love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and remain on you this day and always. Amen. Thanks for joining us, everyone, and we'll see you next time. Take care.